Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV. Television addict! Television addict!
Television addict! Hello, welcome. It's TV Guidance Counselor Day, as it is each and every week here in the terrestrial planet. I am Ken Reed, I'm your host and your TV Guidance Counselor, as we talk about the world of entertainment, television, our youth, and any other weird tangential topic that comes to mind. Today I have two chats with two chaps from the continent of New Zealand. These are both the first two people I think I've ever spoken to from New Zealand. The first one here is Johnny Brugh, who you probably best know as Deacon the Vampire in What We Do in the Shadows, a movie that is essential viewing if you have not seen it. It is one of my favorite comedies of the last few years. For some reason, whenever I say the title, I want to delete the so that it's just What We Do in Shadows. I don't know why my artistic brain does that, but there is a "the" there. He's incredibly funny, super nice guy. I chatted with him back at Denver Comic Con. And my second conversation in this episode is with another New Zealander, Daniel Logan, who played Boba Fett, the young Boba Fett, in Star Wars Attack of the Clones, and also voiced Boba Fett in Clone Wars. Super nice guy, really fascinating story. I think you will enjoy both of these chats. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy my chats with Johnny Brugh and Daniel Logan.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
My guest, Johnny Brugh.
Hi.
Do you know who I am? Do you know who he is? He...
Two.
He appears as Deacon the Vampire in What We Do in the Shadows.
Yeah.
My favorite vampire.
Deacon is going to make an appearance at 6 p.m. tomorrow night for his panel.
Yeah.
I like that it's dancing.
I like that it's after 6 because that's what time he gets up.
Well, actually, it gets quite dark late here, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And it gets quite light early. Woke up at 4 and suddenly it was light at 5. It's summer.
So has anyone heard my show, by the way? It's okay if you don't. You don't have to lie. So this show, I own every issue of TV Guide magazine because I'm not crazy. And someone picks an old issue, we flip through, we talk about shows they watch, is generally the way that it goes. But you're my first guest from New Zealand.
Aww.
Which is very exciting. Oh, thank you, sir. And it's always fascinating to me to talk about television, especially American television, that we thrust upon people in other countries. So I've had people from Pakistan, we send the weirdest shows to people in other countries. And I'm curious what we assaulted you with in New Zealand.
I don't think we get the weird shows. I think we get... I think they sold to us in kind of like as a package deal where the New Zealand networks would buy 4 to 6, maybe 10 shows and play them. And I was going to try my American accent, but I just backed out of that.
Oh, no, it's mine. Yeah, I won't do my New Zealand accent.
Yeah, it's basically Cartman.
Yeah, I imagine you got Baywatch because we gave that to everybody.
Yep. You mean the old one or the new one?
The old one, yeah. I mean, Hasselhoff, the only one.
Yep, we know David Hasselhoff.
We probably sent you Knight Rider because we mostly exported Hasselhoff shows.
So this is going back quite a long way.
Oh yeah, like when you were a kid, growing up, like what kind of stuff were you watching? Here, also,
Steve Austin, the $6 Million Man.
Feel free
was
to
my
flip
favorite
through these
show.
If you need something to jar your memory.
Thank you.
But $6 Million Man is your favorite show?
Yeah, and as a young kid, my parents would manipulate me by saying you don't get to watch it if you don't eat your greens and stuff like that, and I'd be devastated.
Yeah.
Because he was awesome.
That's brutal for a kid. Like, that's like the highlight of your week.
Yeah. I can't just like tape it.
No. Because we didn't
Do
have
you guys still use that phrase? Taping it? I'm going to tape it, watch it later.
Yeah.
So old school.
Well, that's one of the things we talk about on the show is like those of us that grew up sort of pre-millennium remember these shows better than most people because we thought we may never see this again. So we have to record every moment in our brain because we may never see it again, which is why we tend to remember like who played Bigfoot on the $6 Million Man and that kind of stuff.
Who played what?
Andre the Giant was Bigfoot on the $6 Million Man.
I don't remember the Bigfoot.
You don't remember when he fought Bigfoot? They might not have sent that one to New Zealand. You don't remember in deep...
No. Okay, so clearly a lot of this show has slipped my memory.
Yeah. No, I didn't mean to call you out on that. I'm just going to pretend we didn't send that one over.
Goldfish.
Bigfoots are very offensive to people from New Zealand, so culturally.
Bigfoots? No, they're not.
They're not?
No. We find it mildly humorous that Americans think that there are big feet in the mountains. And also, I had a chat with someone who said, so what kind of horror films are you into? And I'm not really a big horror fan. Because, no, just not. Apart from that one, basically, demon-esque horror films. And she laughed and said, I laugh at demon horror films. My father was a theologist. I laugh at them. I mock them. And so, okay, so what are you into? She said, I think the most frightening thing for me would be probed by aliens. And I laughed at her.
You should have called the aliens space demons. And she would have been like, no.
I'm making a show... I'm making a little a little thing about aliens at the moment while I'm over here. Because aliens think there are gold in our asses. That's why they're probing our asses.
Yeah. Yeah.
For gold.
That's what they call that, the honey hole.
Is that what they call it?
I don't know. That's what they call it in the
gold. Can I use that?
In the digging for gold. Yeah, they call it a honey hole. Is there a New Zealand cryptid, like a New Zealand version of Bigfoot? Like, do you have like a mythical monster?
We know all the land. Everyone's been everywhere in New Zealand.
Yeah.
Someone's been to the top of the mountains. We know there are no Bigfoot creatures in New Zealand.
We've checked every inch.
We have cows.
Yeah, which aren't going to attack anyone.
Maybe a rogue cow. Might have gone up into the mountains, but go get it.
Feral cows.
Yeah, that's right.
Is there a show that people from America should watch that's a great like New Zealand show? Because we don't get a lot of shows from New Zealand sent over here.
Well, you've got 800 Words, which is an Australian show that I'm in. Anyone know about that?
Has anyone seen it? One guy.
Your parents might know about it. Yeah, so that's 800 Words. It's a comedy drama. I'm funny in it.
You're funny in everything that you're
in. Well, that's my job, was to be funny in it. So
that's why they hired you.
Yeah.
Because we basically got Australian stuff in the late 80s when America was obsessed with Australia for 2 years. And we got Yahoo Serious and Paul Hogan, and they added an Australian cast member to the Facts of Life, Pippa, who was played by Sherry Crenn. But we never really got New Zealand stuff till like Dead Alive, the Peter Jackson movie.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's well, you get all their movies.
Yeah, but no TV shows. And I'm like, they have to make TV shows.
I think you do, but I think they're just on some obscure channels that you probably don't watch,
right.
And that probably aren't advertised so much
as like New Zealand's hugest show.
Yeah, and maybe they don't translate so well.
Is the humor? But because
well,
of the humor,
I think the humor. Let's look at The Office. Did anyone see the first series of The Office, the UK series?
Yeah, the original, yeah.
And the American version, to me, feels much softer and much more kind. But for me, the fundamental basis of that, of The Office, was is a loose form of British classist comedy where humiliation is the base of comedy, and UK comedy is about humiliation, where you're embarrassed, but you just sort of deal with it. I think American comedy may be more about parody, where a good example would be Scrubs, where there's an emotional story, but the comedy is really pretending to say things. How are you? Great, fine. And you know they're not. But that's a form of sarcasm. And I think that American comedy is different from British like that. And I think Kiwi comedy is probably more in the British vein. But also... Kiwis tend to be self-depreciating. Is that the right phrase?
Self-deprecating?
Self-deprecating,
yeah.
Sorry.
Depreciating, you are worth much less now than you were 10 years ago.
Yeah. when an All Black scores a try, he goes, oh, sorry, to the opposition.
So I look at the New Zealand sort of Australia-UK connection kind of like how Americans look at Canadians. Yeah. It's sort of like a nicer version that's a little more humble than humor-wise. And the one thing we lack here, to your point about the British comedy, is that sort of class system. So, like, in England, they like seeing someone who's sort of upper class humiliated or act like a complete jerk or, you know, the Basil Fawlty kind of thing.
Yeah.
And we don't tend to have that clear social class.
I think America has different social classes based on race.
Yeah.
Versus British class, which is based on money.
Right. Or like schooling.
Yeah, which is all, again, based on
based
money.
Based on money.
Yeah.
Is that similar to New Zealand? Is there that sort of class?
Yes, humor? But I think New Zealand comedy is way more playful in how we have Maori and we have European and then we have Pacific Island. And where I live in Auckland, we have the largest population of Samoan Pacific Islanders live in Auckland, not in Samoa. So and the government insists, you know, we have a kind of an unspoken policy that you have, that you fund works written by Indigenous artists.
Oh,
and
wow.
And that includes Pacific Island artists. And so people like white middle class old men like myself have to find my own money, which is why I'm here.
And you so, got to earn it.
Yeah, I've got to earn it, yeah. I mean, everyone has to earn it, but there's, you know, we'll give some money to projects and in particular films.
Yeah.
And we make some very, we don't make a lot of comedy in New Zealand. It tends to be very culturally based. And it tends to, it would probably satirize, sorry, I'm doing a really bad job of talking about, I mean.
No.
I've come a long way and I've lost half my brain in the process. So I apologize in advance.
It's quite all right.
Being a bit,
you do have less oxygen here, yeah.
I've actually had altitude sickness before. It was like the flu, but without all the sinus congestion.
Yeah. You get basically like the dry bends.
Yeah.
Which is
yeah,
so
but
brutal.
You have great drugs here, so I lay
yeah,
in
there
going,
you go. That's why they have it. Yeah, that's why they have it.
Great.
And a little goes much further because you're almost passing out anyway.
Yeah.
But you know,
to go back to the to New Zealand comedy and you know not a lot of stuff coming over here. I think with people like Taika Waititi, who's a wonderful example of a comedian, because we were all comedians together. You know, so we grew up doing gigs in the same pubs and adoring each other's stuff.
Doing stand-up?
Well, we all did character stand-up.
Okay, yeah.
So, you know, what we do in the shadows, those vampire characters, so those characters would be on stage. They'd be doing stand-up, vampires doing stand-up. And that's essentially what Deacon does in the panel, is he just talks shit as a vampire.
Yeah.
He's himself. And it's quite refreshing, and it's hopefully it's quite cute.
It is. It's very charming to see that sort of, like, I'm a stand-up here, and I started in the UK. And one of the things that always fascinated me about the UK stand-up is they had this sort of alt-comedy revolution in the 80s with things like The Young Ones.
Oh, I love The Young Ones.
My favorite show. Like, that made me move to England.
Yeah,
and
no doubt.
They never had that, like, what's the deal with kind of stand-up that we had here? So people were much more receptive to character comedy, and there were so many more character comedians, and we have almost none here. And so I feel like Australia, New Zealand, and the more British-influenced cultures that have a culture of stand-up, people are okay with someone being, like, clearly that no one's like, this guy thinks he's a vampire.
Yeah.
Or they're like, what's wrong with this
what
guy?
What a fool.
Yeah, yeah. They're on board
unless
with it.
He is a vampire.
Yeah. And I sort of miss that here, but it's still prevalent in other countries.
Yeah, well, I think I don't know much about Denver comedy, but I know LA has a very strong stand-up scene, which is primarily about truths.
Yeah.
And Louis C.K., I think, I love Louis C.K. I was inspired by Rick Mayall from The Young Ones.
Yeah.
It's going back a long way.
Yeah. If you haven't seen The Young Ones, it is the closest thing to a live-action cartoon, but you just never know what's going to happen. And it's still brilliant.
Hi, come in. Sit down.
Yes.
Don't be sorry.
It's quite all right. Yeah.
I'll just start from the beginning.
Yes.
We're talking about comedy.
Yep.
And
have you done the reading?
You've read my notes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, have you got, so you prepared your dance?
Yes. Yes.
Good.
Okay.
No, sorry, only joking.
So that character's inspired by Rick Mayall?
No, I'm inspired, I think as a teen, I watched The Young Ones and became one of those idiots that runs around doing Rick Mayall that all my friends got really tired of.
And bastard!
Just being loud and obnoxious. And then I grew up and invariably became a comedian, and all of these, and then the Jermaine Clement and Taika Waititi, we were all doing characters on stage. And it's really, you can do whatever you want, just like Rick Mayall does and that wave of comedy. And I don't know much about America, but I think stand-up is thought of as what comedy is.
Yeah, also, I mean, stand-up, people always say that there's two uniquely American art forms, jazz and stand-up. And the sort of American version of stand-up, which is a little hoity-toity, but the sort of American version of stand-up that, like, George Carlin, Richard Pryor sort of stand-up.
Yeah, honesty. Yeah, honesty. They just say, this is what I see. You guys see that? Isn't that bullshit?
Yeah.
What the fuck is that?
Here's what I think. Swearing. Yeah, yeah, that kind
then,
of thing.
And then resetting it up for the sake of gags. Yeah. And Louis C.K. and, you know, there's... Yeah, so America does that so well. And then there's... we have lots of comedians who are inspired by American comedians. But I was part of a wave that was a lot more esoteric and a lot less concerned with what the audience thought,
right.
what the audience wanted.
So good comedy.
So so we're at an age now where all kind of we're doing things and people offer money to do things, you know. And you know, it took a lot of hard work for Jermaine Clement and the Flight of the Conchords. Do you guys remember that?
Yeah.
They did 5 years. So we made a lot of amazing short films that obviously didn't come to America, but right. Those guys got together with Brett McKenzie. Brett McKenzie is a musician, a beautiful musician, a producer, and a songwriter, and they got together as comedians, which was unexpected in New Zealand, and they became my favourite and then everyone's favourite. And then they did 5 years of slogging it out at the in Scotland at the Edinburgh Festival there, which you've got to do to get seen. And an HBO agent saw them and then said, just don't sign with anyone else. I'm going to see if I can get some funding to make your show. And then, you know, 10 years later, the show's awesome. And even now you look back at it and, you know, we can look back in time, or I can as a Kiwi, and look at what, and, you know, so can Jermaine. We look at it like 10 years later and, well, we made that.
Yeah.
Well, he made that.
And it holds up. And the interesting thing about that, too, is that they did a radio series in England before the TV series for 3 years. And England still has a tradition of scripted, fictional comedy on the radio, like what people would look at as podcasts now. And we don't have that anymore.
The Mighty Boosh.
Ah, yes. Yep.
Yeah, Mighty Boosh. Yeah. I love it. It takes a while to get into it. It's a bit strange, but once you're in, you're away.
You're like,
and
what
then
is
I really
this?
Wish it could keep going.
Yeah.
So that was a double. Yeah, so creepy, eh?
Yeah.
So creepy.
But the best comedy to me, like, sometimes is scary. Like, sometimes The Young Ones got scary, and, like, SCTV sometimes was kind of scary.
Yeah.
And because it's just so bizarre, which makes it sort of uncomfortable. Which, actually, some of those scenes in What We Do in the Shadows are truly sort of terrifying. Like, some of the stuff with Peter is scary. And when the werewolves transform, like, it's not funny anymore. Like, they're scary, you know?
I think I had the best scene in that whole fight scene. But because it was at night, and the camera was on the guy's shoulder and he was tripping over trying to get the shot, it's in there, but it's so dark you don't see it. There's this very svelte, young, physical motion capture performer who works on Peter Jackson films, who was dressed as a werewolf. And he came running at me completely out of the blue and just jumped on my back. And I went, oh, and then suddenly there was no weight. It's like he almost kind of made it.
Kind of hurdled you?
He was on me and it was so light and I didn't even get pushed forward. You know, you get pushed over.
Yeah.
I was there and he was climbing all around me. And I was like, look guys, I got one. And I was so delighted by that. I was so delighted. There's so many cool scenes in that film that didn't make the cut. Because I think we shot 3 hours of that story and we could only put out an hour and a half, so half of it got cut out.
But a lot of it was improv, so is that why you
the vast majority was improv.
Yeah.
But Tyker and Jermaine would write the script in order to show the producer, in order to show the art department so they knew what they were making, and then just don't show the actors.
Yeah.
So that was entertaining.
Did you keep anything from that movie, like any of your wardrobe or any mementos?
Yes, I brought Deacon's here. He's got his.
Nice.
In fact, all our costumes are in a museum in New Zealand, so I have to ring the museum. Can I have the costume I'm going to see? And they go, oh, yes. And I post about it.
One of my favorite New Zealand things is, and I think it may have been a TV special, but it was Peter Jackson did a thing called Forgotten Silver.
Yeah.
I love that. And no one's really seen it here, and it's so good and so funny. If you've not seen it. It's sort of a fake documentary in the style of what we do in the shadows about New Zealand's first filmmaker, and they make fake silent films saying that it beat America to silent films.
He pioneered film, so he made it out of egg whites.
Yeah,
and it's all not, none of it's true, but it was played on TV in New Zealand and
presented as true.
Wow, the first filmmaker, but yeah. So the first kind of subversive mockumentary, I guess.
Yeah, it was like War of the Worlds or like a funny Blair Witch Project. But yeah. He's a silent film comedian, and his big claim to fame is that he throws pies in babies' faces. So it's almost like a prank show, but like in the teens. So like just footage of this guy that looks like Charlie Chaplin, like throwing pies and like babies in buggies. It's very funny. It sounds more abusive than it
is. Peter Jackson's a silly man, isn't
yes,
he?
Yes, he is. He truly is. And I always wonder if people who really liked Lord of the Rings went back and watched like Meet the Feebles or something with their kids. And are just
His first film, I love Meet the Feebles because of that crazy crack rabbit.
Yes.
But also I liked, what was it called?
Bad Taste.
Bad Taste, yeah. Bad Taste is good. So he shot that over two years on the weekends with his mates. 4 years.
Again, aliens. Very good. Yeah. So your friend whose father was a demonologist would find that movie scary. Because it's about aliens. Yeah.
I should send it to them.
Yes, and go, this is a documentary about aliens that come here. Is there anything you watch now? Are there any shows that you're kind of addicted to or that?
I recently watched an episode of Evil Genius last night, but
they don't warn
you. It's problematic.
Yeah, they don't warn you that you see a guy get blown up in that.
Yeah, that was kind of difficult. I enjoyed The Crown.
It's heavy drama. So you like drama stuff? Like
yeah.
So you don't watch
I like storytelling, and
yeah.
I like cinematography. Comedy, I like. I've got some stand-up comedy going, and that's great. But to chill out, I like watching. I binge on Netflix pretty much.
What's your go-to binge? Oh, stand-up. You watch stand-up?
Not so much.
Yeah, I don't either.
Actually. people insist that I watch stand-up comedy in New Zealand, and sometimes often I really enjoy it, but also I find myself directing stand-up comedians.
Yeah.
And it's fun. And then I sit there watching, and I don't, you know, I remember sitting, I directed this guy, and he had a concept, and he got funded for an innovative concept for his show, and you could argue loosely that I directed it, because comedy's a bit weird like that. And I sat in the front row with my partner, and we watched it, and the whole audience were laughing, and I just thought it was the saddest thing I'd ever seen. And I can't tell you why. I think I was probably engrossed in the structure of it, and that's probably what I do all the time, is I just look at structure of what comedians do. I look at how they set up gags and how much truth is in there, I guess, because truth's important. Truth's valuable to stand-up comedy.
Yeah, absolutely. And it builds trust, too. Like, if the audience doesn't trust you, they're not going to laugh because they're like, I can't trust you to not hurt me, basically.
Well, you know, you've got to be confident. You've got to be fearless. I think if you're going to be a stand-up comedian, give it 2 years of failure.
Oh, yes,
is what I would do. Just fail all the time. Fail, fail, fail. And then you don't care. And then as long as you're observant and you look at the world and you look for things that need to be talked about, then...
Yeah, it's like finding why you don't like things is sometimes more helpful as a stand-up than finding what you think is funny.
Yeah.
I always and I never watch stand-up specials as a stand-up because to me it's like it needs to be done live. So the difference, the way I would explain it is going to a restaurant versus watching Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives. Like you're watching people eat versus actually eating the food. So you can kind of enjoy that and be like, oh, that looks like it's good, but it's not the same.
Eating food is a lot less horrific and terrifying.
That's true. Than a gig. People don't tell you that you're not funny and they hate you when you're eating food.
Are you going to eat like that?
Yeah.
Don't eat food like that. Eat it like this.
I could eat that better than you.
Yeah. Hey, when you eat that sandwich, eat it like this. It's going to be great.
I thought of a thing. When you eat the sandwich, you should swear a lot and be really dirty.
Yeah. And don't wear a suit.
Yeah, yeah. Is there anything you watched as a kid that you go back and revisit, like that's like a comfort show for you?
No.
Okay, really?
No,
Are you not very nostalgic?
Well, I went back and watched The Young Ones because it kind of defined who I was for a long time. And now I look at it, and I still very much enjoy it. And I still like the loose, ridiculous nature of and how free and playful it was and how indulgent it was. And so I don't really have much insight, to be honest. I just really enjoyed. Also, I felt things when I was watching it.
So yeah.
I feel those things again, I guess. Yeah, I mean, freedom.
The Young Ones is, if people haven't seen it, they always have a live band in every episode. It's a sitcom about guys going to college roommates, but a live band will play. And the reason they had a live band, do you know why they would have bands?
Bye.
Do you know why they had bands on the show?
Because that's what they said that they get funding for or something?
Yeah. At the BBC had a very strict budgeting, so if you did a variety show, you got a higher budget than a sitcom. So they would have a band play in the middle of the sitcom because they got a better budget.
Yeah.
Which is great. So you have, that's where I saw The Damned for the first time.
And, yeah, me too.
Yeah, and I was like, I'm 5 years old, and I don't know what this is, but this is everything I like in the world now.
Yeah.
And Motorhead.
Motorhead.
But did you watch any of Rick Mayall's later shows, like Bottom?
Yeah, I loved it.
Yeah.
And Filthy Rich and Cat Flap.
Yeah.
I think it's worth, I've also rewatched a lot of that. I think it's worth watching that to see how whack comedy can be.
Because Filthy Rich,
if you're into comedy.
Absolutely. Filthy Rich and Cat Flap kind of taps into that class thing a little more.
Yeah, that's totally doing that, yeah.
Yeah. Because he's
sleazy idiots.
He plays a politician
idiots.
And his name is like something Bastard. His last name's Bastard.
Oh, Alan Bastard.
Alan Bastard, yes.
Oh, so that's a different show. That was another one on.
Yes.
So that was I liked that for how technical he was and how prepared he was as a performer. Not very interesting.
Yeah, most people probably know him from Drop Dead Fred, if you've seen that movie.
That's a very
Rick Mayall style movie. But Bottom's just very physical. It's a lot of people hitting each other with frying pans.
Yeah, they bash each other with frying pans and then argue over stuff.
Is there anything that didn't make it into What We Do in the Shadows, because you said you shot so much, that aside from the cool fight scene, that you are just like, oh, if there's one thing that we cut out that I could have back in there?
Yes. All my gags.
More of me.
All my gags. There was a scene where Viago and Deacon were sitting making pottery, and Tiger just goes, come on, we're going to make some pottery. And we sat there, and so I started making a thing. And he said, I don't know about love. I meet this girl. I wanted to talk about this girl I met. And I went, tell me this girl that you met. And he goes, well, she's cool, but she's 93. How does she look? He goes, not too good. Do you love her? And he goes, I think I do. Go get her. That's what you need to do. But if I bite her, she'll be 93 forever. Who cares? Don't worry about it. Anyway, that scene, it was way better in the film.
We did
it over and over again. And but I guess the story didn't need it, because when you see Viago standing there looking at the window, having talked about that little silver thing, that did everything, really.
Yeah.
So in many ways, we kind of overshot the story. Which is worth it.
Yeah, it's better to have more than you need than less than you need.
Yeah.
When you're like, there's gaps we have to fill.
Yeah, totally.
Is there, so you're not a big horror person, but why were you drawn towards doing a vampire character? Was there
Well, because just for purely for the humor.
Yeah. Because of the ridiculousness of someone who's been alive for so long and is...
Well, we made a short film called Some Interviews with Some Vampires in 2007, which was the precursor to Shadows. And we all sat around, dressed in costumes we got from the costume shop, and talked about, and tried to address important questions like, why do we have no reflection? And we didn't bother to actually answer it. We just tried to just keep shooting, keep trying. And I got the flu, so I was lying there so sick, so pale, bloodshot, and we shot all night, and it was real tough. So I probably looked really pale and skinny because I was sick as a dog.
But you're just being method at that point.
Yeah, you can say that, yeah. I should have said that before.
Yeah. Does anyone have any questions for John?
Oh, yeah.
About What We Do in Shadows or anything?
About the heady world of comedy, yeah.
Sir.
So after The Hobbit Law passed in New Zealand, have you been having a lot of trouble with the actors' unions, or how do you kind of...
Is this a question about The Hobbit Law? Can you explain the Hobbit Law?
Well,
is it about people with hairy feet?
That's a little bit.
Okay.
Are you being fictional or non-fictional?
No, non-fictional.
Oh, yeah.
I was on The Hobbit, and apparently because Warner Brothers was thrown around their weight a lot, it weakened a lot of the acting guilds in.
Yeah, we got manipulated by producers. American producers manipulated our prime minister. he was so keen. He's the sort of guy who would jump at you to shake your hand,
yeah,
and
yeah,
knock people out of the way.
Please come do work.
Because you're famous,
yeah.
You know? And I think fundamentally it came down to making sure that American productions, when they came to New Zealand, got a decent enough tax break to keep them coming. And I think the New Zealand Actors Guild, which only has about half of New Zealand's actors signed up because the other half are embarrassed of it, which is fairly short-sighted in my view. I think it's better, we'd be better off all being signed up and probably joining up with the Australian Actors Guild, because they have more power and also their contracts are broader. So it just meant that we were getting in the way and making life tough for Peter Jackson. And I don't quite know enough. I couldn't get any work as a Hobbit on any of the films. I tried really hard. But so I couldn't go into too much detail about that. But we're over that, and I think it's probably sorted a few things out for us anyway. And as long as the American productions are coming over and working in New Zealand, then the industry's fine. Because after that saga, the new government that came in decided to scrap all support for the film industry in New Zealand, and suddenly there was nothing being made, no films, and there's, you know, 150,000 Kiwis out of work that are just
conservative government.
Probably more free market, probably right wing, a little bit more right wing, but
yeah,
still,
yeah,
we're very centre. And so they said, "You guys don't need support. You're doing great." And suddenly, everyone who had invested in an editing console or invested in a huge studio had massive debt, millions of dollars of debt. They had no work. And so there was the bit of a big crisis in New Zealand about how to do that. So someone said, "Prime Minister, can we give the tax breaks back?" And he went, "All right, pay them back, and everything's back to normal."
That's how it works in New Zealand. I mean, because you had at
least, so tiny.
It's incredibly small, but you had this 20 years of between the 90s doing like Xena and all those shows there for a decade, and then Lord of the Rings movies basically shooting for 10 years.
Yeah,
you had 20 years of pretty much constant production. And it must be sort of the bottom falls out after that, where you kind of take it for granted, people who've been working for 20 years on more or less two shows.
Well, a lot of my mates I went to art school with my mate Roger owns his own company and is doing very well making props for American productions. But he's having to look to China and America and Australia for work because New Zealand is so small, as am I. You just got to go where the work is, and you got to be ready to work anywhere in the world.
Do you feel like you have to come over here to continue to do...
Well, I love coming over here.
Yeah. When was the first time you came here? Not to Denver, but to America.
1992.
Oh, really? On vacation, or were you doing work?
I was on vacation. No, work-wise, I've started having... The pleasure of doing these conventions means that I have the pleasure of being flown over here, and I get made a fuss of.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's great to see America, and I've read so much about... You know, deep history of the American land and, to a lesser extent, contemporary American politics and culture. But I'm really fascinated. The whole world is fascinated in what happens in America politically and culturally. But I really love coming over and learning about it. You know, you can't critique gun laws. Let's talk about gun laws. Until you come over and understand what it's like to grow up in a place like America and your history and the concept of separating from England, for example, wanting to be a republic, you know, or your own country. That kind of thing I'm learning about.
Yeah, know? It's in the DNA of a country, and it's difficult to understand having not grown up in that place.
Yeah, yeah. And maybe it's similar in New Zealand, but I'm sorry if this is getting boring, guys, and I don't mean to get all serious.
Two people are crying right now for the listeners.
Who's crying?
Is there a TV show or a movie that sort of defined America for you, that you thought it would be like before you came here, and then you're like, this isn't like The Electric Cowboy?
Dallas.
Dallas? A lot of people there was like Dallas.
Yes. But I'm a little bit obsessed with history, with deeper history, and I really, you know, I think Kiwi's got a lot out of Dances with Wolves.
Yeah, no.
Is that
more than the Postman?
What do you guys think of that?
It was controversial.
Does that film do something relevant?
It was controversial at the time, I recall. There were a lot of people who didn't think it accurately represented the Native American experience. But when I've gone back and looked at it, for a lot of people, that was sort of their first exposure to that sort of level of Native American culture in a weird way.
Yeah, I'm fascinated by New Zealand pre-European history and American pre-European history, and but only through, I mean, I've got to say, it's only through fiction writers, because it makes it easy, I guess.
They give you the highlights, sort of.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I know I'm showing my ignorance here, and but I really enjoy reading about history.
Is there a place in America that you still want to visit, like a historical site that you haven't seen that you're like, this is on my list? It's like number one.
Well, I'd like to go back to Utah. I think I prefer the cold over the heat.
Yeah, it's very. Utah can be pretty chilly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I come from Boston. It's very cold. We still had snow when I left.
Yeah.
That's a lie, but it was almost true.
And I want to go to Red Rocks while I'm here. I'm here till Thursday, so after the convention, I'll be looking for a place to stay, and I'll be looking for anyone who's keen to who wants to go to Red Rocks and do something like that. I'm really open to that.
Sing U2 songs on the way over.
Yeah.
Under a blittered sky. Any other questions? Anyone have a question?
Did you get an answer to your question?
Yeah.
Was it an answer you enjoyed?
I was so
enjoyable. Okay. Yes,
feel,
it did constitute
I feel
an answer.
Ill-equipped for some of the more political stuff. But yeah, our scene's kind of fractured, but the technical side's really strong. Yeah.
Would you ever want to do, since you're interested in the sort of geopolitical aspects of history and things, would you ever want to do a comedy set in that world? Like Rick Mayall did, you know,
It's a great idea.
like a political show set in the 1800s.
You mean like who's
another
the guy,
period.
The Mr. Bean? Who,
oh yeah, Rowan Atkinson.
Rowan Atkinson.
Blackadder.
Yeah.
Yeah. Blackadder 2 is fantastic. Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. Is there, what period would you pick?
I don't know. I have to think about this.
You have to pick now, or I'm gonna green light this.
Okay. I'm gonna go way back and dress in a tiger skin loincloth.
Okay, you're going.
Hide under rocks and meet monkeys in the desert.
There was.
I want to do 2001: Space Odyssey
as a comedy.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was an American sitcom called It's About Time. That starred Joey Ross from Car 54, Where Are You? And astronauts who landed in caveman times, and it was astronauts and cavemen, and was maybe the worst sitcom I've ever seen in my life.
Oh my God.
It was painfully unfunny. Yeah, it was like people who were like, Gilligan's Island's a little too edgy. It was not good. But I think someone could do a good version of that. If anyone could pull off a caveman sitcom, I have faith that you could do it.
Well, I am very hairy, so that's just...
not hairy enough to be a hobbit, apparently.
Save on art department. I did a comedy series in Australia called Soulmates, and they had a couple of characters who were cavemen, and they wake up in the morning, and one of them goes, geez, I'm hungry. I might go get a baby. You want a baby? And he goes, the guy goes, I don't know, man. I don't know if we should be eating babies. He goes, why not? They're tasty. And he goes, well, I just think them. Did you notice how Simone burst into tears when we ate her baby? He goes, nah, what are you talking about? I'm going to go get a baby. Do you want one? Nah, I don't want one. Okay, you can have some of mine. Yeah, I'll have some of yours, yeah. So there's some nice gritty sketch comedy there for you. You can find that, Soulmates. It's really good.
It's a sketch show?
Yeah. Yeah, your Australian sketch show.
Okay, yeah, because we get stuff like John Safran came here, like a lot of his stuff, and we got, of course, stuff like Summer Heights High and that kind of thing worked. Again, character comedy. But, you know, there, I feel like there's this untapped pool of these shows being made that that we would enjoy that we don't know about or don't have access to.
Well, we have Netflix now, so it's all there. I mean, it's all going to get sold to Netflix at some point, and American Netflix is vast compared to Kiwi Netflix.
You have your own Netflix, though.
Yeah, but it's small.
So it's like four shows.
Like, don't give us all the shows. Kiwis won't understand.
You have to go to one guy's house. He's the only one that has it. He's got the password.
You've seen six shows?
Yeah. I was going to binge that show, but someone was using Netflix. I had to wait to sign it out. We got a couple more minutes. Any more questions? Questions about vampires, demons? Yes.
Oh, yes.
Oh, so what is?
Oh, you mean a superpower kind of?
Yeah. What vampire power would you really like to have?
Probably flight. I mean, that'd be fun. I'd get vertigo, but I'd get vertigo anyway. Yes.
Yes. What other character?
Of those other characters. None of them. I'd go with Vladislav. I'd have to go with his character. He's so good at it. During the shooting, he would... in the first week, I had no idea what was going on. Can I tell you some anecdotes?
Yeah.
Some anecdotes about the film? We should have done that half an hour ago.
Sorry, jeez.
You look so bored talking about politics. And
we all went to vote one day. And we
So in the first week, because Tyker and Jermaine are much taller than me, the cameras would run, and then these guys would be standing there, and I found myself behind two guys, and I thought, I'd push through to the front, and then I would look back at them, and they'd sort of look at me and smile, and I realized that none of them knew what to say. They were just standing there in front of the camera looking at it. And, you know, in hindsight, it just meant that vampires just stand there looking, not really saying much, which was really good. So there's plenty of footage of us standing there not knowing what to say, which didn't make the cut, obviously, you know. But, so, you know, some of the anecdotes would be, there's a scene where Nick is floating outside and he's knocking on the window, and we open it, it's like, oh, Nick's here, and Nick goes, hey, what are you guys doing? Well, we're making a documentary. He goes, oh, cool. Well, I'm a vampire too. And we don't really want Nick involved because he's a bit weird. And so for that scene, we'd be sitting, the guys wanted to sit on the couch and watch the TV. And Jermaine goes, well, what can we do that's a bit more exciting than watching TV? And I went, what are you talking about? Haven't you got anything in the script? And he goes, yeah, we're just sitting watching TV. And I went, ah. And there's a whole crew of people. There's 40 people standing around waiting to know what we're going to do, we're going to act. And there's two Peter Jackson's huge camera crews that have four people each running. So there's eight people with cameras waiting to know what to shoot. Lighting people waiting to know what to light. Sound people waiting to know what to shoot, wanting to do. And I just thought, well, I've been thinking about what Deacon could be into, and I think erotic dance is probably something he should do. That'd be good, eh? And Jermaine goes, yeah, that'd be good. Do you want to do an erotic dance? And I went, yeah, let's do that. And he goes, hey, Tyker. Hey, Tyker, Johnson's doing an erotic dance, and Tyker's talking to a camera guy, the DOP, and he goes, oh, yeah. And so if we spend an hour going and getting costume and finding snake charming music and stuff. So Jermaine and I are going through songs, and I kind of already knew it should be a kind of ratty snake charmer piece of music, and I should have a fishnet singlet. And amazingly, the fishnet singlet is sitting on a rack, so costume were over the moon about that. And so I spent 45 minutes humiliating myself doing erotic dancing in front of 40 people and two camera crews. And after 2 minutes, you've lost ideas on how to dance. And so Jermaine's doing, watching, he's doing this going. And Tyker's looking in the screen. And then Tyker will go like that. And then so I'll do some arms, get some arms, then he'll just go like that. And then I'll get down. Then he'll sort of go. So,
just how most choreography works.
Yeah, well, the point was don't stop dancing. Don't stop. Keep going for 45 minutes, because those moments in between the dances are where the beauty and the comedy is going to be.
And we thank you for it, because it's a highlight of that film. we would never know that was not your first time erotic dancing.
That was my first time erotic dancing.
That was your first time erotic dancing?
Yeah.
So we have time for probably one more question. Does anyone have a question? About erotic dance or vampires, or it doesn't have to necessarily be. Do people ask you to erotic dance now because of that movie?
Yeah, I do. I'll do an erotic dance at the panel. I also will prove that levitation is possible. I know.
Yes. Is there a mythological creature you would like to play?
You mean werewolves, werehorses, werekiwis, weredogs?
I had an idea once that there were...
Not a werekiwi.
Not a werekiwi, yeah.
Kiwi's a funny national animal, isn't it, for New Zealand? We have a bird called the tui that has the most amazing call. And the early Maori said that when you hear that was a fantail. they're telling lies. When they call, they're telling lies. And so I thought that maybe the tui should be a national bird. Oh, this is boring.
A lying bird?
I haven't played any mythological animals, so what you got?
What animal would you like to see Johnny be? Come on. We
raccoon.
Just get to the point of it.
We're raccoon.
Raccoon, which you don't have in New Zealand.
Back to the spaceship.
Porcupines, yeah.
Griffin.
Griffin?
Yeah.
Griffin's pretty good. Centaur.
Yeah. Sounds great. I'll do all those.
He'll do them all. Erotic dances.
A couple of vodkas, I'll do that for you.
Yep. Well, thank you so much for chatting.
You're welcome.
Today, Deacon's coming. Is it 6 o'clock today?
It's tomorrow.
Tomorrow,
Saturday.
6 o'clock, we'll have Deacon here.
Yeah.
All right, so everyone get your crosses and protect yourselves.
Yeah, and be ready to... it's basically a Deacon's erotic dance class that I'm usually forced to play out for you.
Yeah, it's like a vampire lumbata.
Yeah.
I think the sequel to What We Do in the Shadows should be called Vampire Lumbata.
Oh, yeah, so there is a sequel. There's a TV series
that's being made
at the moment, which Tyker and Jermaine have sold the rights to that, and they'll probably... Jermaine's writing it and Tyker probably direct it, but the original cast won't be in it. It'll have an American it'll have Matt Berry, who's an awesome British comedian,
Toast of London from Mighty Boosh. Look for that. Cool. Well, thank you guys so much. Enjoy the rest of the con.
Thanks, guys.
There's Johnny, super funny guy, great guy. I want to thank him for sitting down and chatting with me. Check out all of his current projects. They all sound pretty fascinating, especially the aliens mining for gold thing. It's the opposite of Watch the Skies. You want to watch the other end. And speaking of aliens, we have an integral part to the Star Wars mythos. Mr. Daniel Logan himself, who played Boba Fett. I know he's very, very popular among... all of you people who listen to the show. He was the young Boba Fett in Attack of the Clones, and he is the voice of Boba Fett in Clone Wars. You can't see it because this is an audio format, but he had a really cool Boba Fett helmet with him, and I'm sure you could Google it and see what that looks like. So please enjoy this conversation I had with Daniel Logan.
I do these conventions. Hey, buddy.
I'm moderating.
I'm moderating.
Sorry. I'm Ken Reed. Sorry.
Don't worry. No, it's perfect. I slipped in the back. You come through the front.
Oh, man.
That's how Boba works.
It's a Boba Fett move.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You think I'm going down the Sarlacc pit, but I'm sneaking out the other side of the desert.
I was looking for jetpacks.
That was
my mistake.
Slave 1 is at the mechanics right now.
Yes. So I apologize.
No, it's okay. It's funny because I'm actually doing a Q&A next. And you don't understand, like, when you come up and you talk about yourself, it's easy. You can talk about yourself all day long, you know what I mean? But when you have to moderate someone else, I have to moderate Jeremy Shader.
Oh, yeah, from Adventure Time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I grew up without cartoons, because I only grew up in New Zealand where we had 3 TV channels. So I never really got to watch much TV besides what you guys watched maybe 20 years ago.
What was some of the American stuff that we assaulted New Zealand with?
Oh, I loved it. So New Zealand, right? The funniest thing, I really only had three TV channels. But what happened was at 11:45, this little Kiwi bird would come on the television and it would sing you like a goodnight song, like, kia ora, good night, New Zealand, and wave to you. And then the TV goes,
you had sign off.
Sign off, yeah. That's why I would tell people. The fourth TV channel was in my mom's bedroom. We just never had access to that channel.
So all the good stuff was on that channel.
Well, no, that's why she had six kids. Oh, my mom never watches these interviews.
So are you placed in the six?
I'm the second youngest.
Okay.
I wish I was the second oldest. Then the second youngest would take care of me. You know? My brothers, they never call me like, hey, how you doing? What's up? They're like, hey, man, can you help me out? Like,
yeah.
My mom doesn't even start with, how are you, son? She's like, hey, son, I need help.
I've gone through the other four, and yeah, you're next on the list.
The other four are useless. I don't even know why I born those four. But you are the money cow. You are the milk.
Are you the only one that's gone into entertainment out of your siblings?
Yeah, only me. People say, where did you get it from? And I said, I have no clue. My nana, my grandmother, she was a beautiful singer. And in New Zealand, we give respect to our fellow veterans and soldiers, and also the ones that we've lost. And they have these community centers, which are called RSAs, Return Services Association. And anyone who's a vet, they can basically go there and they get free meals, low cost on drinks. But then my nana would sit there and sing for them, you know? She had a little band and she would sing, and me and my brothers and sisters would go along and dance in front of her and stuff. And that was really where I think I got the extra of, you can be more than just yourself and entertain the world through mm-hmm. your talents.
So you were playing rugby and you got discovered, is that right?
Yeah. Was a crazy little rugby kid, so my two big brothers wouldn't allow me to be anything but a great rugby player. And back in the day, I was on my way to actually becoming an All Black, which was the national team for New Zealand. And
should we explain, does everyone know rugby's like American football, but for people who are tough?
Or just dumb. We don't have no pads, no helmets, no nothing. It's just people running at people, basically, trying to grab a ball from each other. But so an audition came at my rugby club, and my coach put my name and his son's name down. Well, I walked into the audition room, and as soon as I walked in, it was actually at the rugby club that I was playing for. And I walked in, and all you hear is, oh, he's a little too white. And you're like,
had you ever heard that before in your life?
No, I mean, I grew up in New Zealand where one of my brothers is very brown, the other yeah. one's light brown, my other sister's white, then there's me, you know, yeah. like we look like a fruit salad, you know what I mean? So I kind of was like, what the heck's going on here? And then they were like, no, we wanted you to play a very famous rugby player called Michael Jones in this commercial. Obviously, I was too white to be him, but I managed to somehow talk a couple of words and they liked me. So they were like, hey, look, we have another job. Can you pretend like you're diving into the mud? And at this point, I knew I really needed to get a job. So I'm like, yeah, sure, anything you want. And I just jumped off my feet and I dove into the concrete floors of the rugby club, just like I was diving into a pool. No hands, no nothing. And the ladies just went, oh, I'll never forget that. Oh, perfect. And I got the job that day.
He'll do anything we tell him to.
Yeah, exactly. Like, he's the perfect. Yeah, he's perfect. So I went along and I did it. And I mean, I skidded in the mud. It was perfect. And this lady came up to my mother and said, hey, do you mind if we get your son some more jobs? He seems like he's got some talent here and we could probably use him on other things. So my mom was thinking more of the money because we grew up on welfare. So she's like, oh, yeah, he can bring me. Yes, yes. Yeah, well, how much more work can you get him? So this lady started getting me so much work that she found me an agent. And then that's really how it all worked.
Mostly commercial work?
It was commercial at first because this lady, Pip Grove, she was from an agency called Saatchi & Saatchi. She just had connections, so I didn't have to audition. She just called me, Daniel, you're going to be doing it in New Zealand ad. Daniel, you got a milk ad. Daniel, you got a newspaper ad. Oh, you got a bank ad. And then she's like, you got too many. Like, let's get you an agent.
New Zealand's small. You're doing all the ads.
Exactly. Yeah. I was doing everything. Yeah, exactly. They're like, there was no more jobs for anybody else. I had them all.
Even though I know this isn't true, I'm picturing you, like, as an adult in the ads, as a kid, like, we need someone to be the banker. Now we need someone to play a pilot. It's just like, I'm 10. Yeah.
Call Daniel Logan. Yeah. I was like, George
He's
Lucas.
Real good.
So when my agent took me on, she really fell in love with me, and she started sending me out for everything. And I mean, I was 13 when I auditioned for Star Wars. I was meant to be an 8-year-old little kid. But my agent was so cool. She would send me out for anything from like 3 years old to like 32 years old. She's like, just try. You might get it.
He's got range.
Right? Yeah. We're just trying to find your range. I'm like, you're just desperate. Don't lie. So Star Wars came by and it was funny because I'd gotten these calls forever. Like, hey, we got you an audition. Oh, hey, you got to be here tomorrow. Oh, hey, come by and get your script. Oh, hey, this and this. But this was a call like no other. I mean, she was literally, oh my God. And I'm like, what the heck? Slow down. What's up? And she's like, I got you an audition for Star Wars. And remember, I grew up on an island with 3 TV channels.
You have no idea what it is, right?
I had no clue what Star Wars was. I was like, oh, great. Get me in and we'll get it. And she was like, no, you don't understand. So I was like, what? She's like, you're probably not going to get this. But we're going to be able to forever sell you as the kid that auditioned to be the kid in Star Wars.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, cool. Like, didn't know what Star Wars was, but if they're going to sell me as auditioning for this role, it must be pretty good.
Yeah.
So I went in, and I remember, like, the lady's name was Robin Gerland. And I went to walk into this beautiful hotel room where the interview was with my
man. Was this in New Zealand?
In New Zealand, okay. Yeah. Because they went all over the world. They said that they auditioned like 5,000 children worldwide for the role of Boba, but never told any of us that he was actually going to be Boba. All they wanted to do was interview us and find out a little bit about us and what we loved, what our passions were, what we did on a daily basis and stuff like that. So I had no clue who I was playing, even after auditioning for 3 months.
It wasn't that it would make a difference if they told
me. Oh, yeah, I might. Oh, but no, it's funny because when they told me that I was going to be playing Boba Fett, I asked some of the ADs, I was like, oh, cool. What kind of Jedi is he? And they're like, no, kid, you are really, yes. So they had me sit at the studio with the first 3 movies, and I just watched them over and over and over. And that's how I kind of got to know who this character Boba Fett was.
But it's still not a ton. I mean, there's not a lot.
Oh, no, there's nothing. I'm like, what do you mean? You want me just to create, basically?
Yeah.
But that's where Ewan McGregor, Temuera Morrison, Jango Fett, everyone helped to make that character so powerful. Like that first scene where I come to the, Tonwi and Obi-Wan come to my house, and I open the door and I do that face, like, I couldn't get that face right. And George, he was kind of like pulling his hair out, like, oh my God, Daniel, just do what I tell you to do, you know? And I'm like, just look at someone suspicious, like you don't know why they're there, but they're there, and you're kind of suspicious of it. So I'm like, oh, kind of like when the police officers come to my house for my brothers, and then George is like,
sure.
No, he's like, what? No. Who do I have working for me? Background check this kid and his whole family. So I guess that wasn't the look. So Ewan pulls me aside, and Ewan's like, Daniel, just do a face like I did a very smelly fart. Can you do that? And I'm like, yeah, sure, I can do that. So he opens the door, and I'm like, and I do the face, but you can see my nostrils moving, and because it was so close on my face, you could see every little movement. So George calls cut, everyone starts laughing. Ewan spits in my face, they've laughed. He's like, I'm like, what's going on here? So they take me to the monitor. I'm looking at the monitor, and I say to George, isn't that what you wanted? So George turns me back, yeah, Daniel, replays it and says, rewinds it and says, everything besides the nostrils. And as you see, like, as he says the nostrils, you just see me like. So for like 8 takes after that, it was so hard not to look at Ewan without doing the nostrils. But then Ewan would come to the door and be like. Well, my mom is pretty hardcore. She had to raise me as a mother and a father. So not only was she the lover, but she was the discipliner too. And it just happened to be when I was working, she more wanted to discipline me than she wanted to be loving. That's why I loved it when my grandmother came on set, because I could just run wild. And I could feel her passing red eyes through that dark studio just staring at me like, you better stop stuffing up, boy. So I kind of had to turn to you and like, buddy, I have to go home with that. You know,
hey, professional actor, stop pranking the 13-year-old kid who really needs this gig.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, I'm the only one out of all of us that need this, guys.
Yeah.
So, you know, they allowed for Boba to be able to become more powerful than what I was able to produce or project because I was so young. But when it came to imagery, I could see everything. Like George would say, well, Daniel, there's a droid over there, and it's blowing up, and there's a smoke rising to the sky. Can you see that? And I'm like, George's like, oh my God, that's me. You know, he's like, this kid is great, yeah. You know? But being a 31-year-old man, trying to become an, you know, use your imagination again, it's very hard.
Yeah.
That little kid had so much confidence, so much imagination. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, I mean, it probably served you well that you didn't have a preconceived set of ideals of what Star Wars should be.
Exactly.
Because that character especially is so iconic, but so vague. So you have everyone who loves a character that there's really no character.
Yeah.
So like most actors would be like, great, I can make this my own, but it's a really weird, unique situation where you absolutely can't.
Nah. So although he didn't do much, there's still enough for people to stuff it up. You know? Like, you can't just go and be Boba and be like, hey, what's up, guys? You know, like, to your head. Like, Boba now has that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's not like he's looking up, like, scanning. He, like, looks down, and then as he's looking down, he kind of, like, looks across the bottom, like, see how much of a nerd I am of Boba Fett now? I had no clue Star Wars when I first got in the world. Now you can't shut me up about it. I mean, my friends and I, all we do is talk about backstories now, you know? We're like, oh, yeah, but that would be cool if I just, maybe I could build a stormtrooper next. My buddy's like, you can't be a stormtrooper. I'm like, I can be anything I want. This is Star Wars. Yeah. Like, no, bro, you're Boba. So you can only be Jango, Cody, Boba, Commando this, da-da-da, you know, holiday special, this. I'm like, what the?
Yeah. Don't tell me what
I
can do.
I'm Boba Fett. No, I'm just No, but so now we have all these jokes like, you know, who I can and can't be. So now I'm actually working on a holiday special.
Oh, nice.
We just built a whole entire Empire Strikes Back armor. It's pretty phenomenal.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, it's really cool.
How secretive was the set? So, I mean, it was probably, obviously it's a big Hollywood movie, which, you know, I'm sure you worked in professional sets on commercials, but this has got to be, you know, exponentially different, and they're probably not letting you see scripts and keep.
No, they did.
Yeah.
Everybody else wasn't allowed to see nothing. Only just because George is kind of like that. He will film from the middle to the end to the beginning to the quarter to the middle, back to the, you know. So it's all like a puzzle that you have to try and figure out at the end of the day. Like, oh, okay, that's right. That one goes with that one. That one goes there. Boom, boom, boom. So he just lays it out at the end of the day. But while you're filming, you have no clue of the sequence. Because one day you're in the beginning of the movie. Well, then the next day you're filming the end of the movie. Where when you're an actor, you can't see where the visualization of George's you know, mindset is.
Yeah.
So, me, I was so young, and I think it was that I didn't know Star Wars, that I was allowed to go everywhere. Like, when I wasn't filming, I was sitting watching the other guys doing their sets, or, you know, I was helping this guy get him coffee, or I was driving this person on a golf cart to the makeup room, like, where most people weren't allowed to do that.
Yeah.
Only simply because of the confidentiality, and they didn't want every, you know, the rest of the actors to know the rest of the scenes or the rest of everyone else's part of the film.
Was there any of the actors in that movie that you had seen in things or you were familiar with before the movie?
You know what? The only two people. It was really weird. So, first person was my father, Jango Fett, and I really wanted to meet him because he played in a movie called Once Were Warriors.
Yes, great movie.
Yeah, unbelievable. When you meet the two of them, you're like, yeah. Before you meet them, you're like, what are you doing? And then you meet them both, and you're like, yes, keep going. No, just joking. I love Rayne Owens. I love.
Yeah.
I know them both now because the mother of that movie actually was Ton Wee in Star Wars, and then my father happened to be the same father who was Jake the Mus. But he was a very, very powerful actor, and becoming the fact that he came from New Zealand, it really gave. You know, love not only to my country, but it showed that people from small island like where I come from can still make it in the world of Hollywood. And I really, really wanted to meet him. But I totally forgot about Ewan McGregor. So we were in the makeup room for quite a while together. And I would just start reciting his lines from
Trainspotting.
You
should not have seen it 13.
Trainspotting. And he's like, oh man. And I'm like saying all these lines. When I first meet him, I'm like, oh, you're the guy who goes down the toilet to get that thing, right? And he's like, now watching it as an adult, I'm like,
of all the things.
Out of all the things I remembered, that was the one thing that you went and got.
Yeah.
So I would start reciting his lines back to him in the makeup chair. And he's like, looking at me like, where's your parents? Like, Yeah. Who's taking care of you, you know? How do you know this movie? And I'd respond back like, oh, no, it's cool. She's never around. She works all the time. My brothers are the ones who take care of me, and they watch these movies. They let me watch it, too.
We learned a lesson. But just say no from this. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Just say no, kids. So
you did a Hercules. Was that before Star Wars?
Yeah, that was before. Okay. Hercules was one of the first breaks into like something that I really saw as being a professional American set. I got to play a little demon child that played against Kevin Sorbonne and Kevin Smith before he passed. And it was really cool because I was so nervous because I was a big Hercules fan when I worked with Kevin Sorbonne that he was this American man. And he was on my island of New Zealand. And we all looked at him as really a god of like Hercules. So when he stood there and he was a huge Hercules man, I remember just being in awe with him. Because although we only had three TV channels, Hercules did come on that TV.
Action translates.
Yeah. I mean, Power Rangers was shut off my TV. Even though they filmed Power Rangers in New Zealand, they banned it. Why, you ask? Because all of us little crazy savages didn't realize it was a movie and we'd go to school and fight each other.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I'm the Black Power Ranger today. We're having so many fights at school that they had to cancel it off the TV just because the kids were really taking it seriously. No, that's no joke. So I only ever watched the original, and then they're like, oh, they made like 25 other ones, and I'm like, they did?
How did the kids survive from fighting each other?
But then when the ones I do watch, I met Jason David Franks, he's now a friend, and I'm like, dude, that was badass, bro, that was so sweet. He's like, yeah, that was none of us. What?
Japanese footage.
You're the Japanese guys. Yeah. I'm like, what? He goes, we just did the take off the mask. Why? Hello, 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 good looking stuff. And then when I went to the fights, it was all the Japanese. I'm like, I'm over this franchise. But yeah, we had, going back, so we had Married with Children. That was my favorite because it came on when I was staying up late. My mom was still at work those nights. It was like 11 o'clock it would come on. So it would stay on for that 45 minutes right before the Kiwi bird would say goodbye to us.
What a way to go to bed.
And I always remembered, I wish I had a father that would just hand me money. You know, like he's just sitting on the couch and the next one, thank you. Next one. And then the wife, she's like, More. Now being married, I understand that. Yeah. I have to go to the wife to ask for the money, you know? Like, can I get some of my money?
So when? How old were you when you first came to the U.S.? Because they didn't shoot Star Wars in America, did they?
No, I did a little bit of filming in the U.S., and that was only like a week, and I got to do that up in San Francisco. But we mainly filmed in Sydney, Australia, and I filmed for about 2 months, 2.5 months. But I moved to the United States when I was almost 16. Yeah, I left my family, my friends, my home, everyone I knew, and I came across, and I didn't know what I was going to do, and I had no idea of what my life was going to become, trying to do it by myself. But I asked George Lucas to write me a letter for my immigration. So my lawyer said to me, you know, Daniel, this will probably take about 6 months, so you're going to have to go back to New Zealand for 6 months until this is approved or we can figure out what's going on. So I went, it took me a week to get like my flights and everything, and then by the time I actually got my flights and everything arranged, I went back and I was there for like less than a day, and I get a call from my lawyer, and she said, this is unheard of, but you have actually been approved. And I was like, what? And my mom hated it at the point, because she was like, you'll be back in 3 weeks, you know, and it's been now,
16 years?
16 years I've been in the U.S. So I've lived more of my life here in the U.S. than I have in the country I was born in. But I was like, but not only did I ask George, but I asked Ewan McGregor too. So I got these two letterheads from George Lucas and Ewan McGregor that actually helped me with my immigration to this country. So not only did he give me a great job that helped me to see the world and meet wonderful people like you, but he allowed me to move to this country and also now meet my wife and have a beautiful child. And it all stems from Star Wars, you know, but then again, it all goes back to George Lucas.
You never know where that, you know, growing up as I did, you know, very blue collar and in a small place, you're like, how did it hits you when you're around these people or at these things, like, what, how is this still a thing, I imagine?
Just got to keep your prayers alive, you know? People say, how did you get that audition out of the 5,000 children? I said, I was just the kid that prayed the most. They're like, what are you talking about? I said, well, kids usually pray one or two times. I was praying four or five times a day, you know? In between lunch at school, like, hey, God, thank you for this meal, but thank you for Star Wars and that audition. Let me go. Now I just pray to George Lucas.
Yeah, well, he is. I mean, if there's any people whose God he is, it's everyone in this room. Were there American television shows or movies that you thought it would be like here when you first came and then it wasn't, or like, did you think it'll be all like Married with Children?
No, it was just, that's all I basically had was Married with Children. Like, when I had to start auditioning for American stuff, my agent would say, go home and watch some news, American TV. I'm like, dude, we grew up, we had welfare most of our lives. We have three channels, yeah. You know, like, there's no American on there.
Yeah.
It costs to watch American TV. So there was nothing I can really relate it to. And that was the funny thing is that, going back to the audition process, you know, the original Boba Fett, Jeremy Bullock, I would sit and someone would say, hey, how'd you get the process? How'd you get it? How do you think you were the one who got the role after all those 5,000 children? And I said, well, you know, I would laugh and say, well, I'm a big believer in God, but I think I was the one who prayed the most. And Jeremy Bullock's like, no. And I was like, what? He's like, think about all those movie tapes that George Lucas had to watch. There was like 5,000 of them, right? He probably got to like 200, 300, needed to go restroom or take a drink or do something, right? So he just froze on this face. It just happened to be my face on the TV screen. When he came back, he no longer wanted to watch any more of those audition tapes. He says, you know what? Just call this kid. He would do.
What a way to diminish your accomplishment.
Right. I said, thank you, Grandpa Fett. So Jeremy and I, we're like, he's really an idol of mine. And out of this whole Star Wars world, we actually have a really close bond. Being the fact that we're the same character, it's really weird. Because you see the two Darths, like Anakin and Darth Vader, and they're both like... And then you come over to the boba tables and we're like, hey, how you doing, you know? Even Jeremy Bullock, he's a little old, but he's still standing there in front of the table, you know? He's a good guy.
Did you get any of like the merchandising and stuff at, when the movie came out? Did they send you like,
oh, so this is
stuff?
So they would literally send me like a box like this big by like that big. It cost, back in the day, shipping was expensive. So it cost like $300 or $400 just to send me this box of toys. That's how big these boxes were. And then they were sending me like two or three of these boxes at the same at once. So it was like opening the best Christmas present like ever. So I had all of these, all of the toys that had been made before episode 2 and prior. But the thing was, is my toys or my figures all had a special coating on them because they were actually Lucasfilm. So Lucasfilm actually has their own, that they'll have a special code, which most people don't know, on the back of the card. But then when they sell them, the Hasbro and all the rest, they just are standard figures. So all of mine were actually worth two or three times more than the actual regular figure because of the fact that they were Lucasfilm barcoded. So I just kept all of mine. I put them in every single like closet, under my bed, you know, my drawers, everywhere. I kept them all pretty mint condition. So when I moved to the States, I get a call from my little sister, and she's like, oh, wow, I like this one toy and this other toy, and I'm playing with this one, and I've opened all these other. I'm like,
oh,
what?
No.
It was before FaceTime, so I kind of get on the phone with my mom. I'm like, what's going on? She's like, oh, yeah, I didn't mind. She opened some of your Star Wars toys. I'm like, what? So I go back to New Zealand, and my little sister had opened them all. So it was like her Christmas. Like, once she opened one, she was like, oh, I can open another. And you know that feeling of opening something or putting on a fresh pair of socks? She must have got addicted to it and just opened them all up. Well, she didn't keep all the bits and pieces with each other, and my mom wasn't very educated, the only way I can really politely put that. And she threw them all away.
Ugh.
I had all the Master replica lightsabers, every single color, and I found a couple of them when I went back there a couple of years ago, but she hadn't taken out the batteries out of them, so it had corroded the entire inside of my Master replica lightsabers, and they're all like $800 a piece now.
Yeah, yeah.
Or more. So, yeah, I love my mom, you know? That's why I don't live with her anymore.
Someone can get
it. So how much more money you need this week? Okay, cool. I'll send it. As long as I don't have to come see you.
There you go. Yeah.
I'm still hurting by those figures that you threw away. That was my son's, you know, college fund.
Right. I'm sure we'll crowdsource you them again. We'll get them
back. But you know what? The coolest thing was that I actually was up at Lucas Ranch, and because I had never seen Star Wars, I had no clue what characters were at the time. And Rick McCullum really took me in, and he let me walk around anywhere. Like, the ranch was like my second home. So I walked up into his office, and they had a Stormtrooper helmet sitting right there. And I don't know why, but I knew this thing was probably worth something of value. And I was like, oh, wow, like, what's this? You know, and Rick's like, oh, that's a Stormtrooper. We used that in the remake, or they redid one of the old films.
They reshot some of the scenes, yeah.
This was one of the helmets that they used in it, and da-da-da, and he ended up just taking it from set. And I'm like, oh, I've always wanted a Stormtrooper helmet.
From this movie I never saw.
Exactly. Well, it just happened to be, I got back home, and the boxes always happened to me. beat me before. You know, it was like they had rush packaging or whatever.
Should have shipped your cell phone.
Would've I would have got there faster. No, because George actually sent me and my family to Disneyland.
Oh, nice.
When California Theme Park just came out, he gave us this amazing tour. We had this suite that you open the back doors and you have Disneyland on one side and California Theme Park the other side. It was incredible. But yeah, I got home and the Stormtrooper helmet was in the box. And I was like, yes, that a boy. Because my mom was the type of person, like, you never ask for anything. You know, and if someone offers you something, you don't ever overtake. Like, if they're offering you like this, you just say, I'll take that. Thank you. Like, if they're offering you a bunch of grapes, you better only ever take one grape. But they're offering me the whole bunch. Yeah. You take one. You know, and it's like, so I had to kind of learn that system. But with this helmet, I was like, I managed to manipulate it, and I got it. Even though my mom was there, I still got it.
You still have it?
I still have it, yeah. I was going to put it in, I forgot his name. He has a huge museum. Oh, I always forget his name. I was in talks of, like, putting my helmet in his museum, but I just never got around to doing it.
Yeah, well, you still have it.
And my dad has it in his office, so I think my dad rather be in his office than in some museum.
Yeah,
you know, so.
Yeah, it's his personal museum.
Exactly.
Was there anything you took from the set or anything you kept?
Episode 2, I just took memories. That was really it. You know, I didn't realize the value of the things that I was wearing or the things that I could have stolen. No. I could be a millionaire. It wasn't until I went on to episode 3 because they held me for a year for episode 3. I was meant to come back, and the storylines of any of you have seen, it was Boba was meant to kill Mace Windu. But it just didn't work out that way, and he had a different death. But I went on to set anyway. Towards the end of filming, and they're like destroying the lava scene, and I'm just seeing all these like big, like, you know, trucks just dumping all this lava into these big old bins. So I asked again, Rick McCullum, I said, hey, who does that trash belong to? He's like, well, once it's in the can, it doesn't belong to us. So I said, do you mind if I go and grab a couple bits out of your trash can? And he's like, sure. So there, Boba Fett's dumpster diving in the back of it. You know, I mean, this is a big dumpster, too. Like, I was little, and I'm just throwing these big pieces of lava out. I'm like, hey, this one good pops. He's like, so we just brought home suitcases full of this lava. But because I live in California where it's very hot, I didn't store any of the lava. So it's all made on, like, this foam, and I think these pieces were, like, this big, and now they're kind of, like, this big.
Paperweights now.
Yeah. And then I got blue screen, too, and I'm like, oh, hey, this would be great. I could just make these out into, like, little boxes and tell people this was, like, off the set of Star Wars. And I look at these pieces of blue, like, foam now, and I'm like,
what was I thinking
when I was in the dumpster?
Very industrious. I mean,
I got a little too excited, you know? I went a little too dumpster excited.
We get dumpster crazy sometimes. Yeah.
Have you seen Extreme Cheapskates?
Yes.
I love that show. So here's my ADHD going on me, and it's images. So there's a show called Extreme Cheapskates, and I thought about myself when I was in that dumpster. But this lady, she would go to a dumpster, and she would go and pick out food out of dumpsters, and then she would have people over at her house, and she would cook for them. Well, her guests would be like, oh, this is amazing, da-da-da-da. Like, at the end of the meal, for some weird reason, she would feel like she'd have to tell them, well, hey, I actually foraged for that in the bushes, and that I got out of the dumpster, and that I got from the back of a Save-On or something. I just scraped off a bit of the mold. And you see these people, like, at the end of it, they're like, oh, wow, this is good. And then you see at the end of it, like, when she tells them, they're like...
They call themselves freegans.
Freegans, is that what they call them?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh man, don't tell my buddy Greg Sipes about that. You guys know Greg Sipes? I got so many friends in this business now. He's like, hey, that's what's up. That's what's up. I'm gonna be a free vegan. I'm gonna go dumpster diving.
Freegan sounds good.
Yeah, that's what's up. He plays Beast Boy on Teen Titans. He's cool. Yeah, hippiest person I know. But if you want some uplifting energy, you know, you just hang out with Greg Sipes. He's always positive.
So let's take some questions from the crowd.
Oh, yeah, any questions? Perfect. You guys have a great day. Nah, go ahead.
This one? So I'll repeat the question in case everyone didn't hear. There's talks about a Boba Fett standalone movie. Or have you been involved in talks in any way?
If they don't call me, I'm not watching it.
That's one less ticket they're selling.
You know, I think social media has been wonderful for me, and also the fact that Boba has had a revamp through everyone wanting this new movie. It was funny because when I first got on social media about 2 years ago, there was another director who was said to be brought on from Fantastic Four, and he was going to change the character. And I'm like, no, no, no. So at that point, I came out, and I'm like, guys, because you remember with the head-cutting scene where people were like, why did the head not fall out of the helmet? Well, I become so much of a nerd that I go back and I find why it didn't fall out. And then I actually found that it did fall out. So I'd go and tell the world, like, you got to go back and watch it. So now the world knows that it actually does come out. If you watch in freeze frame, you see a shadowing of the head leave the helmet. You know what I'm saying? It's the same as this. So once I heard about competition, I'm like, no, guys. And the fans are awesome. But then it kind of ruined it for me. I'm like, guys, Boba is a clone of Django. If there's any adult Boba, it should be Django. And then people are like, oh. I'm like, he is the clone, right? So at the end in the cloning process, when Boba finishes cloning, he should end up turning into looking like Jango Fett. So technically, Boba's Jango, Jango's Boba. So I could be young Jango. And people are like, this is, see what kind of conversations I have.
So people are like,
now everyone's like, yeah, that would be great for this new movie, but if it's old, it should be Jango. Sorry, Daniel. And I'm like, that's no offense taken anyway.
It's my theory.
It was my theory. Yeah. And he's like my uncle, you know? Yeah. He's like my Star Wars father, but he's actually really like my uncle in real life. So if it was to help him and his family, that's all I want. Yeah. You know, just like when Rey was, you guys have all seen Solo?
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's long enough. There.
I didn't even know that. You know, I went toilet. I came back. As I came back from the toilet, there was a guy with a hood on. I'm like, what? Who's this new character? Oh! You know, I was like,
yeah.
And I was sitting like three seats away from Rey. I was like, you never told me this whole time we're training?
He wasn't 13. They didn't let him tell anyone.
What a dick. Yeah, he didn't, you know, so I forgot what I was saying.
Talking about characters coming back for the movies. And
oh, yeah, yeah. So Red, back to the...
Yeah,
so,
Darth Maul being the new one.
So you can really see the love of generations, right? So you have the original, you know, 4, 5, and 6. Those are the diehard fans that when Boba came back in the prequels, they were like, well, we didn't want to see the face. Well, hey, look, we wanted this, or hey, you did okay, or this and that, but we wanted the guy in the armor. Then you have the new generation, or the younger generation, which is our age, you know, your 20s to 30s, who saw the prequels. They grew up with that block of Star Wars. I became their Boba Fett, you know, and you have all these young kids like, hey, if it's not you, we're going to boycott, you know, and at home, you go on Instagram some days going, please don't let anyone talk bad about me, and oh, it's all good. Then you have the one guy who talks bad, and you're like,
yeah.
Start writing a bad message back, and then you realize, oh, I'm Boba Fett.
Yeah, you can.
delete,
yeah.
You know?
People forget that you're a real person, I think, when you're in these movies that they feel an ownership of.
Oh, yeah,
because
very much.
They just like it. And it's like, I mean, a kid. I was a kid of an actor in this movie. Like, it's not...
Look what happened to Jake Lloyd, and then also the other lady from... Exactly. You know, Star Wars is such a loved franchise and such a loved movie that people are going to have their opinion no matter what. But it's the type of movie that you have to have thick skin. I grew up being a boxer. So when I was growing up from 8 to 13, I was boxing competitively. So I was fighting people bigger than me in a ring. So when I ended up going into the Star Wars world, I had 8 bodyguards, and I never realized until I met Jake Lloyd of what had happened to him. He had been death threats sent to his house. He had people stalking him, trying to, you know, staying outside of his house and stuff like that. They literally had to move from L.A. to Indiana just to get away from the threat and everything else that people were saying that he sucked so bad. Well, when people told me I sucked, I was on the internet when it first came out, like just MySpace. And I'd be in there like, come on then, let's fight. Come meet me, you know?
Give me your address. I'm heading over.
I'm like, well, don't talk crap on the internet. Come and fight me then, bro, you know? Well, I didn't realize. So then my manager would come in when I'm just like about to write return or enter. You know, no, what are you doing? Delete, 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 delete. You know, get off social media. You can't be on it. And I took it differently. I took it like, you guys gonna bully me? I'm gonna bully you back, you know? Then training with Ray Park, now people are like, oh, I don't know if we want to talk so much crap on Daniel Logan anymore. Like, he's got a little bit of the Sith side of him now. But I just had a whole different response. Like, negativity doesn't ever absorb into me. You know, people say negative things. Like, okay, how can we turn that mindset or that vision around? You know what I mean? So coming back to the question, I pray. You never know when Boba will turn in the franchise in Star Wars, right? All we know is his bounties are far from over. Unless they start the movie at the Sarlacc pit. Then it's up to you guys. People say to me, do you think Boba Fett really died? I said, no, because he's like Tupac. And people were like, what are you talking about? I said, people love him so much, they don't believe he's dead. He ain't dead.
Oh, I thought you were going to say he was murdered by Biggie Smalls.
No.
Who's kind of like
he
Jabba.
He could have been. I was about to say, Jabba could have had something to do with his death.
Yeah. I think Jabba Bobby is a bit like Biggie Tupac.
I like that. I'm going to do a whole new expanded universe on the Biggie and the Tupac.
Yeah.
You know.
I would listen to Jabba's hip-hop album.
You know, MC Chris did do a good, Boba Fett.
Yeah.
So this guy shows up with this Corvette and it's like wrapped in a Boba Fett, right? So I give him a shout out on my Instagram. I'm like, hey, what a cool car. People start retweeting it saying, you got to go check out Daniel Logan's Corvette. I'm like, dude, I drive a Toyota Tacoma and a Toyota Prius.
I don't own that Corvette. Don't try to tax me on that.
Yeah. I'm like, hey, George, keep hiring me, all right? I'm still struggling, George.
I mean, I would. If you wanted me to have that Corvette, I'd have it.
I would drive that around. Amen.
Other questions?
Yeah, that guy had a question. Yeah,
Oh man. Sure. Any regretful acting jobs?
Nah, acting is acting. You know, I love to act. I love to be creative, and I love that I can go somewhere and show off and become someone else without getting in trouble for it.
You get to be kind of a con man.
Because my mom was like, you're a show off. Go to your room.
Yeah.
Back to my room, you know? So I spent a lot of time in my room by myself. That's why when George asked me if I could see these things, everything I could see because they were hanging out with me every day anyway. But I don't regret, but I tell you a funny story. People are like, you and Sharknado? And my old response was like, hey, sometimes you just got to pay the bills. But I actually did enjoy working on Sharknado. It was fun, but there was a situation which I wasn't really too comfortable with. They called me and they said, would you like to do it? I said, yeah, perfect. I was flying back from somewhere else. I had like a day and then I had to go do it. Well, they flew in that morning from somewhere else, and I guess the script writer had just been writing the script like on a piece of paper in the airplane on the way to the...
It's Sharknado.
On the way to set. So I'm like, oh, cool. Can I get my script? The guy's like, oh, I'm still writing it. One sec. I'm like... So, all right, whatever. Like... Professional, you better be able to learn these, act them in 2 minutes, right? So I walk in to go and get wardrobe, and there's these beautiful ladies because they're all stewardesses. So I'm like, wow, this is gonna be a good shoot. Like, surrounded by some beautiful actresses, this is already started the day off. So they welcome me on set. Hey, welcome, you're gonna be great. We got someone new. I had not realized yet that one of the Sharknado guys knew one of the guys who was filming, Pan Am? I don't know. I've never seen it.
Pan Am, the TV series.
The TV series.
Yes. Christina Ricci was on that series.
Yes. Yeah.
So David Harbour, who's here at the convention.
We were on their set. Well, I didn't realize that when they broke for lunch, we get to go and hijack the set for 1 hour, and then that's all we got. So, meanwhile, I just had a handwritten script. The script didn't make sense. I had to rewrite it all myself. Then I found out that this is not even my set, and all these pretty women that have welcomed me onto the set, I ain't even going to be working with. Plus, I've got 1 hour to get this thing done, and if I don't, what am I going to do? They come back from lunch. They take their set back over. So I'm sitting there, like, stressing, sweating. I didn't show the stress, but I'm, like, nervous. I'm in it. I'm, like, got a big cigar in my mouth, and I'm not used to cigars, so it's, like, disintegrating in my mouth. So I'm, like, you know? No regrets. But it was just part of that film magic, you know?
It's like freaking movies.
So I just did a film with the... I signed a thing that I wouldn't talk bad on this film set for Funko and Valve. I don't think this is talking bad, so if they try to sue me, I'll just get my better lawyers on them too.
I'll talk to them.
No, they got good ones.
I'll talk to them.
But so they call me up, and like, hey, Daniel, you mind if I'm filming our movie, this, this, and this? And I'm like, yeah, sure. So I just come back from Brazil, and the Brazil convention was phenomenal. There was like 40,000 people. They flew me first class from LA back and forth. So I had to change my flights around for this movie set I did. Actually, it was the Philippines last year. We just did China this year. So I'm like, yeah, sure, no problem. They're like, okay, cool. Well, we're going to fly you out. Economy and this and this. And he's my friend. So I'm like, dude, any way to get me there? No problem. So then I get there. I flew from Brazil, which took me like 30-something hours to get back to L.A. I had a 9-hour stop at my house to wash my clothes and then repack and then get back on a plane. And then I'm out to the Philippines. Meanwhile, my wife was pregnant at the time. So I get there, my wife sends me a message saying, Daniel, like, you flew over economy class 15 hours. You gotta go check out your friend JDF's page. He flew over first class. He's got this beautiful laid down bed, this and this. I'm like, what? So I'm like, oh, well, it's okay, babe, don't worry. So one of the actors, he's done nothing, comes up and he's like, oh man, how big's your room? And I'm like, oh, it's like a king size bed and a toilet and bathroom and a TV.
It's just a room.
He's like, oh man, I got a 1,000 square foot room. What the heck? So I come back and I start training out with Ray, and I'm like, Ray, like, these things that I talked to some of the other actors on this last set, this happened, right? And he's like, Daniel, you're a SAG actor. Like, you gotta realize, like, you have these things that they have to, like, pay for. Like, I'm just a nice guy. I don't care. You drive me over on a bus, and I'll get on the bus. But once you start realizing other people have more perks than you do, and you actually do have a little bit of a name, you're like, what's going on here? So I try to ask for a business class flight for the next flight for China. So the guy's, oh man, you're like a prima donna. I'm like, dude, I thought I was the only one being nice out of this. You know, I asked for nothing, da 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 da. So the guy's like, yeah, I'll get you a business class flight. So I'm like, all right, I'm starting to feel famous again. I get on an Air Filipino flight, right? This flight is so old, it's like got carpet on the walls, and I could probably still smoke cigarettes in it if I smoked.
It was like the Pan Am set.
Yes, it was like the Pan Am set. Exactly. It was so old. I mean, it was incredible. So I get on, and I kind of get woken up to, we'll be landing here soon. Da, da, da. I'm like, wow, that was a quick flight. I don't realize they're actually stopping us off in Guam. They bought the most budget of the budget flight. So my plane was so old that when they overpacked that flight, we were going against the winds. We were running out of gas. So the pilot made an emergency landing in Guam. Well, I had to go from Guam to Hong Kong, Philippines to Hong Kong, which was only one flight out. And I was like an hour or two delayed. So I'm like, guys, I got to do this film, da 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 da. So I don't know who called the airline, but they actually held the plane for like an hour for me. And I mean, and I was like, while I was walking, there was no one there. It was weird. And I'm thinking to myself, in America, this would never happen.
No, no.
I'm like, sorry, sir, you missed your flight, but we can put you on the next available one. That's tomorrow morning.
Yeah. And it's like, no, I missed your flight.
I am Boba Fett.
Sounds like
put me on that flight.
Sounds like in Guam, they were one step away from asking the passengers to pitch in for gas.
Oh, it was pretty much, I was like,
that around.
I was the first time that I booked a flight straight to Philippines or straight somewhere, and the pilot decided, no, we're gonna stop. Like, forget everyone on the plane. Like, we're stopping. Like, you guys might have other connections, but we won't make it unless we...
I need a smoke break.
Something like that, you know? But yeah, so never no regrets. It's just fun stories that you have to deal with that you don't really think of, you know what I mean? They all almost felt like they're fairy tales and blissfulness, but sometimes it's those things that you're like, what?
It's like being an office temp in a lot of ways. Like, you probably show up and you're like, I worked at this .com for 2 weeks, and they had a chef and video games. Yeah. And then you'll be like, I worked in a warehouse.
Packing boxes.
Packing boxes was awful.
Like, I had to bring my own lunch.
Yeah, yeah. They made me pay them. Do you have a question?
Yeah, that was me.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was all me. And, you know, it was so hard because I'm a physical actor. As you see, like, I like to communicate. I like to, whenever I talk with someone, I you know, as I move, right? Well, with a microphone, you hear the pitch of the sound of me. Yeah. We're out. Where on, when you're doing a voiceover, a cartoon, you have to stay like this the whole entire time. You can't let any of your body movement move because it would take away from the power of the voice, or it might make you move like this and then it doesn't sound right. So when they go to, you know, edit it later on, you're the only person who didn't, who moved off the mic. But if you're doing like, get him, Dad, get him! Like, and you're wearing like scratchy clothes, well, you don't have that option anymore to lift your hand up and get that power out of it. All you have is, get him, Dad, get him! You know, and you're trying to think, okay, my hand just went up, I felt the hand, I can feel it, but it's not, but it is, you know? We had 6 episodes of me killing. They asked me not to talk about it, but they won't release them, so I'm going to start talking about them. Now,
well, if you ain't going to release them, I'm going to start talking about them. Clone Wars?
The Clone Wars. You know, it was so cool because... As of lately, I I went and rewatched the Cad Bane standoff fight between me and him, and that was actually a whole entire episode. That was a 45-minute episode that we had recorded, and you only got to see that small little, like, 2-3-minute clip. Well, there was 6 of those, or more, I can't remember, that we recorded. I went in the studio booth, I saw the roughs. You know, they were amazing. But you never know.
Did they just not fit the storylines of the new direction they were going in?
No, they fitted perfectly. Boba was about to show us everything that we wanted and more. I started crying, and I don't cry. My brothers taught me only girls cry. So I had to kind of grow up with a shell, you know? Even I go to my room and I cry by myself.
Yeah, that's why we have cars.
I really started crying. Like, when I read these scripts, it was like when I saw my child for the first time, Nash was like, it was beautiful. And then they canned him. I'm like, gosh. Ugh. Thank you, Disney, for... Well, the reason why they said that, I was told, because I wasn't even told that we were getting them canned. We recorded them. I was like, dude, I'm back. Like, Boba's back. And this is the most beautiful thing. And then I watched one of the last episode and the scrolling credits. I was like, wait, this is not right. Like, they don't... Where's Tom Kane's voice? Next week on The Clone Wars. You know, like, that's what we're used to. And I was like, there's something wrong here. And that's when I called my publicist, and she said, yeah, it's been canned. Disney doesn't want to show kids killing, and they canned it.
And were you like, can I point you to Bambi?
Oh, you know, the saddest part was, though, was that one set that they, or that one bit that they do see, you see me in armor.
Yeah, it's what you wanted.
And I actually got some respect out of that whole entire cartoon by... Now being the reason for why the dent was given into the helmet, we now see that, well, even though it was cartoonized, because of George Lucas's canon, you know what I mean? And I was the character under that helmet of when he got shot, you know what I mean? And if you saw the rest of it, which they say I shouldn't talk about, but Boba actually sits up at the end of it. It shows that Cad Bane doesn't get up and Boba gets up. And there's Boba's face underneath the helmet. So they actually really did put me in the armor. Just in cartoon version.
Yeah.
And I was like this close. Ugh. I mean, I was actually this close because they did release
it's done.
The bam bam scene. You know, they just didn't release the sitting up.
Huh.
And then from there, Boba just starts going and doing his thing, and he starts getting more respect from the other bounty hunters, and they start doing some pretty cool stuff together that you start to see why he's such a badass little kid.
Other questions?
I was thinking George Lucas could have just saved it for like one more month, you know?
Yeah.
Don't sell just for 2 more months, George. I need this.
You have that power?
Right. You have enough money? Just, I need this. I need the residual checks. Sorry, who was asking the question?
Do you have any, like, affinity for one of the groups, like Sith, Jedi,
Mandalorian,
like, you pick any of those sides?
Do you pick enough, so they're...
So there's a
factions?
Whole bunch of like, well, and now, blessful to the, you know, cosplayers and stuff, there's all different groups, right? I would be more, I found more love towards the Mandalorian mercs, just because I relate to them, and they're my type of people. Like, there'll be a whole bunch of drunk guys in a pool with their helmets on, you know, just having a good old time, you know, and it's like, that's what Star Wars is about. It's not about being part of a group like the 501st, not talking crap, you know, and... You literally have to look identical to one of the characters, or your costume must be over $10,000 in order for you to be accepted into my group. I don't think that's fair. I think Star Wars was made for everybody, especially the kids. And for me, the Mandalorian mercs seem that they allow everyone. If you can pay for a $250 white armor that you get sent to yourself, put a black jumpsuit underneath it and paint it yourself, you're accepted. And that's how I am. I accept everybody, and we all don't have $10,000 to spend on an armor or... you know, $8,000 to look identical like a Jedi, you know? But there's a lot of us out there that love and have passion for these characters and the armor and whatnot, that we all deserve to be a part of something.
Yeah, and if anything, put in more work.
Exactly.
To sort of make up for the lack of funds.
People don't understand, but when you're underneath that armor, I mean, it's hot. I mean, then you put the helmet on, you can't breathe most of the day, you know? And if you're in it for more than 2 hours, it's uncomfortable. You can't sit down. The gauntlets are eating at your arms. The neck pieces, if you have a jetpack on, it's sticking into your neck, you know, so you're constantly pulling on this. You know, it's not comfortable, but it's fun. And that's what Star Wars was based on. We got to be a part of something bigger than ourselves.
Modern day mythology.
5 more questions, guys. 5 more questions. Now, he said 5 more minutes. Okay, you and then you. Yes. So my buddy Wasted Fett, he's on Instagram. He's the coolest guy ever. He came up to me and Django Fett drunk one day at Celebration, and we were sitting there not drunk, and he comes up wanting to arm wrestle Django Fett, and like, this guy's like this big, and I look over at my poor old father, and I'm like, dude, he's like 80 years old, and you want to arm wrestle him? You'll rip his arm off. So he's like, no, I'm joking, but I'm the biggest fan. I want to make you guys a helmet. The Mandalorian Mercs actually did make me a helmet, but it came out, it didn't set right. But like a Honda Civic, I would be proud to drive anything, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So like, I just thought it was the coolest helmet because I had one. So I'd take this all over conventions with me. And then this one guy came and was like, man, like, it's a little bit of embarrassment. And I was like, what? He goes, dude, we have better helmets than you have, and you actually Boba Fett. And I was like, what? Well, and he's like, I would like to make you one. So I was like, if you want to make me one, make me the whole entire armor. And he was like, really? Like, it was his honor. And I was like, really? So we both had this, like, love really, really moment, you know? So for the last year, he built me an ESB, Empire Strikes Back, and it's literally identical to the armor that was worn by all the rest of the Bobas in the original. But right now, we're having a holiday special being made. And I love my life, you know, because I don't have much money, but when I have bargaining chips, it helps. So Waste of Fest's like, hey, can you get me into San Diego Comic-Con? Well, I just know the organizer. So I'm like, I might be able to get you a pass. He's like, dude, if you can get me a pass or two, I'll make you a holiday special. Of course I will get you passes to San Diego Comic-Con. So then he's like, hey, if I make you a Django, would you get me a ticket to Celebration? I said, buddy, I will give you my ticket to Celebration. So yeah, now I'm getting these other armors. Like I got a whole Boba. When I get home, I'm getting my mannequin. So I'm gonna have my Boba in my mannequin in my house. But yeah, holiday special's coming, and then Django Fit will come after that. We're actually gonna be doing it's Father's Day tomorrow. We'll start it tomorrow. So we're gonna be doing a Father's Day giveaway of a Django Fit helmet. And we did it May the 4th, 3 days before May the 4th, or 2.5 days before May the 4th. And we raised $2,500 for St. Jude Hospital.
What's the website people can go to?
No, they just go to Make-A-Wish or St. Jude. They pay their donation, and then they just DM me or Waste Effect, and they show us the proof of their of their donation. And then their name automatically goes into a drawing.
Oh, that's great.
I mean, I have so many of these guys on social media that I see that go, hey, like, donate to this or PayPal to this, and you'll go in a raffle. And I'm like, well, where's that money going?
Yeah.
But I'm the type of person, I just want to get back. So if I actually have proof that you paid these people straight directly to them, well, then you deserve to be in the running. And last time we gave away a holiday special. And it was a beautiful helmet. It was the blue holiday special. And yeah, we raised $2,500 in just 3 days. I was like, man, that's why I love Star Wars.
Yeah.
You know? Sorry, my stories go on. Give us another five. I'm on the next one too. But so I'll tell you a really quick story. Carrie Fisher passed away, right? After she passed away, her manager took the dog. Well, her manager didn't have Carrie Fisher's money or her family's money. And as a manager, you can't really call Carrie Fisher's daughter and be like every week, like, hey, can I get money for dog food? Hey, the dog needs vet bills. Can you help? So at the last celebration, I told her manager to bring the dog and we'll sit up at my table and we'll just like do like pitches with the dog and whatever someone wants to pay, they can pay and it goes straight towards you, towards the dog. You know, I don't care if it's for dog food, dog treats, dog toys, medical things that come in the future, like whatever. And so they set up. And this dog had a longer line than I did. And I'm like, what the heck?
Well, he never does cons.
I'm like, I should be sitting, with the rarity of it. But I was like, I should be sitting at your table at the next con. But to see the love of Star Wars fans, there was no number. People would just come up, can I take a picture? What's the donation? Or whatever. They would just pull out their wallets, bam. You know, straight to the, and I'm just sitting there like, because it's a set price, obviously. The convention set the price for the actors. But with the dog, the fans of Star Wars were just incredible. It wasn't even like they thought about it. They just, some gave them $100 for a picture. You know, I was like, that's Star Wars.
Yeah, absolutely.
Darth Maul.
You want to be Darth Maul?
No.
Do you have to fight Ray Park for it?
Yeah, yeah. What do you do? You know what? To tell you the truth, I would love to be Boba again. I mean, I just want to be Boba. You know, I know there's so many other characters, and growing up, I was like, oh, I would love to be Ray Park or Darth Maul or be that character. But tell you the truth, I just love Boba Fett. You know, I would like to play a young Jango. I thought that would be cool if we did a backstory of Jango Fett and like where his mother and father came from, because obviously he wasn't a clone. You know what I mean? So Jango actually probably did have a mother and a father, and who were those people? You know? Any more questions? Yes. You know what's funny? I do. I do a lot. I just had a son, though, so he's taken up all my time of video gaming, so I haven't been able to, but when the last Battlefront game came out, I was on it hardcore, and I called Lucasfilm. I'm like, hey, do you mind giving me a code so that I could get the game, you know, and I don't have to pay for it before everyone else? So they gave it to me like a week before everyone else, and I was, because I'm a Call of Duty guy, I was still finding it a little difficult and challenging. So I realized that you had to buy in-game purchases. So I hit up Lucasfilm again. I said, is there any way I can get some in-game purchases? They're like, don't get carried away, kid. Like, you have to play like everyone else.
We sent you the helmet.
Yeah, they're like, that's EA. They give the coupons away. We just get the game. So I was like, oh, Matt, all right. Well, thanks for giving me the game anyway. So I do. I thought about it.
So we are out of time because we got to turn the room around. But thank you guys so much. And you're doing the next panel with Jeremy?
I'm going to be doing the next panel with Jeremy Shader.
Yep.
That's going to be very exciting. Yep. He was on Adventure Time. So it's actually my first time hosting an MC.
Well.
My hands are sweating. I'm already thinking of it. That's why I don't want to shut up, because I'm like, I got to hear that next.
All right. Great. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so very much for listening to my recordings.
There you go. I hope you enjoyed that even half as much as I enjoyed recording it and talking to those guys. Great guys. Someday I'll visit New Zealand. I think we do have some listeners in New Zealand, as far as I can tell from the downloads, unless you guys are using weird proxies and funneling your downloads through New Zealand in order to throw the government off your scent because you listen to the show but you don't want anyone to know. Either way, thank you for listening. If you'd like to email me from New Zealand or from wherever you listen, you can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com, icanread.com, that's not a thing, but dove.com might be, I don't know. But anyway, it's icanread. I'm out of breath, it's hot, I've been doing yard work, that's not my style. I need to be wealthy so I can hire someone to do these things, but... sadly not to be. If you'd like to make me wealthy, you could donate a ton of money to the Patreon. TVGuidanceCounselor.com is a link to the Patreon, or just go to Patreon/TVGuidanceCounselor. Anyway, I gotta get back to yard work. So I'll see you again next week for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
But also, Kiwis tend to be self-depreciating. Is that the right phrase?
Self-deprecating?
Self-deprecating, yeah. Sorry.
Depreciating, you are worth much less now than you were 10 years ago.
Yeah.